Tim, I don't think this is such a good idea coming to this graveyard so late at night. After all, it is Halloween. Who knows what spooky things might appear in this graveyard? Now, as a physicist, I don't believe in ghosts or goblins. Why wasn't I afraid when that came right up to my nose? Why wasn't I afraid it was going to hit me, bash my face in? It's because although I don't believe in ghosts and goblins, I do believe in the conservation of energy. Because the conservation of energy has a much deeper connection with physics than anything that has to do with supernatural things. It comes from the fact that we believe that the laws that govern our universe don't change in time. If they were to change in time, energy wouldn't be conserved. If you observed energy not being conserved, in other words, energy being created out of nothing or energy disappearing, it would mean that the physical laws actually changed in time. So, gotta get this. There are all sorts of energies, all sorts of energy that we have. Someone did some work to lift the pumpkin up to a certain height. So they put energy into it. It was now at this height. And now the pumpkin had some potential energy. The potential energy is given by the mass times the acceleration of gravity, which those two things are the weight, times the height above the ground that the pumpkin was lifted. Then, gravity, by the way, is a very special force. When you put energy into it, you always get back what you put in because it's called a conservative force. You don't lose any energy in the process. So when I lift something up against gravity, if I then let go of it, it will swing, and when it's at the bottom of the arc, it will have converted that potential energy that was up here into kinetic energy. Now, kinetic energy is given by 1/2 times the mass times the velocity squared. And we've converted all the potential energy that we had up there to kinetic energy here. And then as the pumpkin started to rise, and it rose up to this point over here, it lost its kinetic energy and gained back the kinetic energy, energy always being conserved. So the fact that this was released at a height exactly equal to the height over there meant that that pumpkin was not going to swing any higher. It wasn't going to hit my nose and bash my face in. So I was not afraid. I didn't flinch. And this is just a pendulum, and it swings forth, back and forth, transferring kinetic energy into potential energy and back and forth again. With a period, it works like a clock. It works like clockwork, back and forth, back and forth. Now, it's true that a little bit of energy is lost as it swings due to air friction with the air, but very little, as long as the pumpkin is very massive. Okay, so, the period of this clock is the square root of the length of the pendulum divided by the acceleration of gravity, which is about 9.8 meters per second squared. So energy comes in many forms. We talked about kinetic energy. That's the energy of motion, 1/2 mv squared. But then there's also rotational kinetic energy. You can be not moving but rotating, and that has rotational kinetic energy in it. And then you have heat energy. When something is moving and smashes against a wall, say, it doesn't bounce off always with the same velocity that it came off at, so it lost some kinetic energy. But what happened to that energy that we lost? It went into, it banged against the wall and the molecules started moving, and molecular motion is heat. And so there's heat energy. You can readily convert gravitational potential energy into kinetic energy and then into heat. Oops, I stepped on this. Okay. So over here, I'm going to release a ball from this height over here. It's going to roll down this chute here. It's going to acquire some very little kinetic energy because it's not dropping by very much. But then at the end, it's going to drop onto a metal plate and make a noise. If I were to, the potential energy is mgh. So the higher you go, the more energy you have. So you go really high, and you get a lot more energy. And when it hits that plate, some energy was converted into sound energy, but also into heating the plate a little bit. Over here, I have two ball bearings. May I have a volunteer? Okay. I would like you to hold this paper from the top, hanging down. Okay, I'm going to take these ball bearings, and I'm going to smash them together onto the paper many times. And then after I do that, I want you to show everyone the piece of paper and smell it and tell people what it smells like. Okay? Okay, show them the paper. Okay, now smell it. What do you smell?
It doesn't smell good.
Hannity, what does it smell like?
Metal.
Metal? How about you? What does it smell like?
Metallic.
Okay, let's do this again. So what do you have?
Science.
Okay, smell it quickly.
Burning? Yeah.
What does it smell like?
Burning.
It smells like burning. So the kinetic energy of these balls, you can pass that around, got converted into heat energy, and it burnt the paper, burnt holes in the paper. If I was going even faster, it would get more and more heat. So about 65 million years ago, a giant meteor hit the Earth, and it was carrying a lot of energy. And it hit the area of the Earth now known as the Yucatan, and it landed a little bit in the water and a little bit on land, mostly on water, and it just vaporized a huge column of material. It created a vacuum channel through the atmosphere. That column of material just got blown upward. This was the biggest explosion ever on Earth, and it circulated around the Earth and blocked out the sun for a period of, they think, about 1 or 2 years. And during that time, photosynthesis pretty much shut down on the planet, and animals like the dinosaurs that needed to eat every day couldn't eat, and they died off because of this giant impact that converted kinetic energy into heat energy when it hit the Earth. Okay? So there's also electromagnetic energy. And so some people, this is Halloween, so if you have a ghost sitting next to you, I think it would show up as a less warm body. So check carefully. Make sure there's no ghost sitting next to you or behind you. Wave your hands. This is an infrared camera, and you are generating electromagnetic energy, which is an electromagnetic wave, but it's in the infrared part of the spectrum. If you were hotter, you're only you know, room temperature about 300 Kelvin. If you were hotter, about 5,000 Kelvin, like the sun, you wouldn't be glowing in the infrared. You'd be glowing, it'd be peaking in the visible, like our sun. What? Oh, open your mouth. Okay, let's go back to the camera. Okay, open your mouths so you can see the warmth. Big as you can. You're warmer inside. Okay. Okay, so in addition to electromagnetic energy, which is around us all the time, and in fact delivers the energy from the sun so that we can live. I mean, we wouldn't be alive today on this planet if electromagnetic waves didn't carry energy from the sun, from that fusion reactor in the sky, to the Earth to allow photosynthesis to take place and for us to be able to eat plants and live. We wouldn't be here. Earth would be an ice cube. So it's a good thing the sun is out there, and it's a good thing that there's electromagnetic radiation. You can also store energy in chemical bonds. And a chemical bond is, well, when you have a reaction that takes place in a chemical reaction, energy can be released if it's an exothermic reaction. I have some calcium carbide here. I'm going to pour some water in here. And I'm then going to place some calcium carbide, which, when mixed with water, makes acetylene gas. I'm going to put this in there, put a ball in here, and then I'm going to... Whoa! I think that's the best we've ever had it. I think so. I think it's the best we've ever had it. Okay, so a lot of energy can be stored in chemical potential energy and chemical bonds. Physicists use a unit of energy called the electron volt to measure such chemical energies, and typical chemical energies are about few electron volt or so. And so for every atom that undergoes a reaction, you get about an electron volt of energy, and if you have enough atoms, you get a lot of energy. So when we eat our food, the energy that came from the sun is stored through photosynthesis in chemical bonds, and then we burn it in our body. We burn it in our body to allow ourselves to, you know, do things, extend muscles, walk, talk. That's how we go about our business every day. Now, chemical bonds have about, as I said, an electron volt or so of energy per atom. Nuclear bonds have a much larger energy. Each atom that splits generates millions of electron volts of energy. So nuclear energy provides millions of times more energy per atom than chemical energy. And that's why it is so powerful. And so they're basically reconfigurations of nuclear bonds. Let's talk about how much energy is in typical things that we do. Ah, thank you. Now, how much energy is there in a firecracker or can? Now, for this, I'm going to use three units. One is joules, okay, which is the physics unit of energy, and then I'm going to convert that to calories, and people know how much a calorie is. And then I'm going to convert it to pumpkin meters. Because this is a new unit for this Saturday morning physics. A pumpkin weighs about 4 kilograms, or about 10 pounds, something like that. And if you raise a pumpkin up, mg is about, 4 kilograms times acceleration of gravity is about 10, so that's about 40. And you raise it up by 1 meter, and you get pumpkin meters. Okay, so that's a pumpkin meter. Okay, a pumpkin raised to a height of 1 meter. So in a firecracker or the cannon over there, which is gone now, I guess they took it away. In that cannon, we had about 25,000 joules of energy, or about 6 calories. It also had 625 pumpkin meters. Okay, so now that you know what a pumpkin meter is, a piece of Halloween candy generates about 250 kilojoules, or that's about 60 calories. Okay, and that's 6250 pumpkin meters. Okay, 24 hours of your heart beating requires an energy of about 80 kilojoules, which is about 20 calories, which is 2,000 pumpkin meters. So now you have a feeling for how big these things are. An ice cube, just sitting there, the heat energy contained in an ice cube, because everything, even an ice cube, has molecular motion inside, that has about 4,000 joules, or about 1 calorie, or about 100 pumpkin meters. Okay? The room lights in this room in just 1 hour uses about 1,600 watts, which is 1 hour of 1,600 watts is 5 megajoules. That's 1,200 calories or 125 kilopumpkin meters. A passenger jet moving at 600 miles per hour is about 15, is using about 15 kilojoules, gigajoules, what's that? 3.7 million calories, yeah, or 400 mega pumpkin meters. And a 1 minute cell phone call is about 500 joules, or about a half a calorie, or about 12.5 pumpkin meters. And a typical Michigan football play where people are running into each other, just like those, the ball bearings, but they're running into each other, the amount of energy is about 160 kilojoules, or about 40 calories, or about 800 pumpkin meters. Okay, so now you know how much you live on, how much we use.
Hey, Greg.
Yeah?
The last line?
Yeah.
Stump Greg, I put that on there.
Okay.
That means we're going to see if somebody here can stump you.
Ooh.
Come up with some idea of something that Greg can figure out what the energy is. Anybody?
Okay.
Okay, how about you?
Yes.
How much energy was in that meteor?
That killed off the dinosaurs? Well, I don't know it offhand, but let me try to calculate it. Can we turn on some lights here? Should I do it on this board? Okay, so I got to calculate 1/2 mv squared. So that giant meteor was about 10 kilometers across, about the size of Ann Arbor. Okay, so 10 kilometers equals, that's 5 kilometer radius. The radius equals 5 kilometers. So that's 5 × 10³ meters. Got to get everything in meters and rational units, OK? So the density, let's figure out the density of this thing. The density, well, iron's about 8 point something, high, and meteors are made of lots of iron, but it's also stones and stuff like that. So let's assume that it's like, stones are like 2. So let's say it's 5, okay? 5 grams per cubic centimeter, okay? Now, that's 5 × 10³ kilograms per cubic meter, because there's 1 million cubic meters in a cubic centimeter. I mean, there's 1 million cubic centimeters in a cubic meter, because it's 100 by 100 by 100. And then there's 10 to the 3, 1,000 kilograms in a gram. So the density is about 5 times 10 to the 3 kilograms per cubic meter. So now I'm going to calculate the mass. I've got to get the mass, the first one. The mass is the density times the volume. So I've got to calculate the volume. So the volume, let's do this quickly, 4/3 pi r cubed. So I'll cancel the pi in the 3, make it easy. This is how physicists think, you know? So we got 4, let's call that 5, times, sorry, 5 times 5 times 10 to the 3 meters cubed. Okay, so let's see, we're calling 4 or 5. So this is about 600, 5 times 5 times 5 is 125 times 5 is 600. So let's call that 5 times 500. And then I got to cube this, so I get 10 to the 9th. So I get 5 times 10 to the 11th times 10 to the 11th cubic meters. Let me put that in here. So I got 5 times 10 to the 3 kilograms per cubic meter times 5 times 10 to the 11th cubic meters. There's kilograms per cubic meter. Does cancel, and I get 5 times 5 is 25, so it's 2.5 times 10, 11, 12, 11, 14, 15 times 10 to the 15 kilograms. Did I get that right? Let's see. Yeah. Okay, 11, 12, 13, 14. Yeah. Okay, so I've got that many kilograms. So that's the mass. 1/2, 2.5 times 10 to the 15. Okay, that's the mass. And now I got to figure out the velocity. The velocity was about, well, everything in the solar system has a velocity of about 20 kilometers per second. Yeah. So let's, you know, give or take a factor of 3 or something, okay? So let's put that in. 20 kilometers a second is 2 times 10. That's 10. A kilometer is 1,000 meters. That's 10 to the 3. So it's 2 times 10 to the 4. That's meters per second. 20 kilometers per second. And I got to square that. So let's do all this. So if I square this, I can cancel one of these 2s with this 2. Multiply this 2 times that, I get 5 times 10 to the 8th plus 15 is 23. So I get 5 times 10 to the 23 joules. Okay, now, to convert that to calories, I got to divide by 4,000, right?
4184.
I'll just do 4,000. Okay? So, in fact, I'm going to divide by 5,000 to make it easy. So if I divide by 5,000, I get 10 to the 20 joules. I mean, 10 to the 20 calories. Divide by 5,000. I get 10 to the 20 calories. That's a lot of calories. You know how big you'd get if you had that much calories? And to convert to pumpkin meters, I got to divide by, I got to divide by 40 or so, so they make it 50. And so, let's see, where's my number? 50, I got 10 to the 22 joules, right? That's 20 to 22 pumpkin meters. Okay, let's just have another unit. Let's introduce another unit because, you know, although we're used to pumpkin meters, these are really big numbers. Let's convert this to kilotons of TNT equivalent. Okay? I happen to know that 1 kiloton of TNT equivalent is equal to 4 terajoules, is equal to 4 times 10 to the 12 joules. So 5 times 10 to the 23 joules divided by 5 times 10 to the 12, I made the 4 and 5. It's okay. Okay? That gives me, and this is joules per kiloton TNT equivalent. So I do that, and I get 10 to the 11th kilotons TNT equivalent. And so that's 10 to the 9th megatons. Ah, 10 to the 8th, sorry. 10 to the 8th megatons, which is 100 million megatons, TNT equivalent. That's a big bomb. And it hit the Earth, and it almost wiped everything out. Luckily, we, or our ancestors, survived. Because we were like little rodents at that time, burying little seeds, and we didn't need the photosynthesis for a year. We could survive off the seeds.
So Wikipedia, just to check yours, said 100
yes. Oh, I was right. Hey, so you couldn't stump Greg.
Do you have the clicker?
Somewhere.
Oh, you're right there.
Okay, good. Cool. All right. By the way, way of introduction, that was Greg Tarle, physicist. If we don't run out of time, he'll be back. And Greg has been here at the University of Michigan since 1984. He's an astrophysicist and a cosmologist. And believe it or not, he teaches a course on energy and the energy in our future. Last year, he gave a Saturday morning physics talk, pumpkin meters. And he's a pumpkin eater, yes. All right, hi, everybody. So this is special Saturday morning physics, and I'm Tim Chupp, in case you didn't know, one of the organizers this year. I've been here since 1992, and I'm basically a subatomic physicist. I do atomic and nuclear physics. So actually, many people over the past several weeks have managed to recognize me and come up to me and said, what is this physics of Halloween thing all about? And you have a pretty good idea now. After the first half hour, but actually back then I couldn't say, I really didn't know, at least definitely what it was, but I knew it started here, that there's physics in everything. There's physics in a football play, there's physics in motion, there's physics in clocks, as those of you who were here last week know, of course there's physics in motion, physics in the weather, and physics in food, and why not physics in Halloween? There's got to be, right? There's physics in everything. And the reason that many of you come here every week is to kind of learn what's new in physics and in science and what's going on and get to see what we're doing. But what we're actually doing every day, if anybody has a physicist in the family, is actually not, you know, intricate, incisive calculations that are at the discovery level, confirmable by Wikipedia. Nor are we, unfortunately, toiling in the lab enough. But what we're doing is just what everybody's doing, is we're kind of living, but we do it in kind of a nerdy way, right? So when we look at things, we look at them in maybe a slightly different way. We try to figure out if, you know, what we're seeing, what we're hearing, whatever it is, you know, kind of makes sense to us as physicists. So the idea of physics of Halloween is to do that, is to do some things. Basically, the Halloween tricks, the Halloween decorations that you just don't have at home, and figure out what's going on. Okay, so you know, swinging pumpkins you may well have at home. If you don't, that's an easy one. But I want to take a look at the following. So this is kind of a cool thing. Yeah, what we have here is a blue tube. The blue tube is around, there's a coil here, all right?
And that coil is basically plugged into the wall and it has a switch. And I don't know if you can hear this. You know, it's humming at 60 times a second. And you can kind of hear that. And one of the sort of cool things is that, that this thing can kind of just be, it's, sometimes we call it spooky. In fact, physicists for centuries considered the fact that you can actually have forces, all right, this force on this ring counteracting gravity, you can actually have a force that there's no, you know, visible wires, you know, no visible strings. There's nothing visibly holding it up. It's action at a distance. It's spooky. Halloween. All right, Halloween. But other things can happen, and we want to understand this, so watch this. Woo! All right? Why did that happen? Okay? I'm going to answer. Okay. Right. So let's understand. Oh, that was the Michigan football play, yeah. So let's understand what's going on. So here's the blue tube with the ring around it, okay? And remember that there is this 60 hertz magnetic field, and what's here is a bunch of iron things that, in a sense, this is an electromagnet down here, and that magnetism gets transferred, still changing back and forth at 60 cycles per 60 times per second through by these iron rods all the way up this tube, okay? And so I just have a bunch of pictures to try to illustrate that for you here today, so let me work through this. That's the 60 cycles. This is milliseconds along the bottom, okay? So two cycles takes about 32 milliseconds. If we look at the first quarter of a cycle, I'm going to do it this way. If you can look at the first quarter of a cycle right about here, in fact, I can make it like that. This thing is an electromagnet down here. This isn't going to be easy. This thing is an electromagnet, and so it has a north pole and a south pole. All magnets do, all right? But that is a changing magnet. That's what's one of the special things that you can do with electromagnets is make them change. And what we know is that there is a phenomenon in physics which is a law, okay? So it happens every time the magnetic field changes, this happens. That's why we call it a law, and it's called Faraday's law, and Faraday's law induction. How many people have heard of that? Quite a few. All right. But here's what it does in this case, all right? What Faraday's induction does is induces in the ring a current. And the direction of that current is something that I, you know, we all force our introductory physics students to figure out many, many times, three or four times on each exam, et cetera. But the interesting thing about that is now that ring is an electromagnet itself because it has a current flowing in it, all right? And those are the magnetic field lines. I just moved it over there so you can see more of the magnetic field lines. It's a magnet, which is the North Pole and which is the South Pole? All right, well, I'll tell you. I think. supposed to advance. Okay? The ring becomes a magnet, and the magnet is like that. But it's over here, remember? Okay? So now what we have are two north poles facing each other, and this is exactly what you saw, is that there's a significant repulsion. Okay? And very, very fast. And when you have a fast, significant repulsion, it gets an impulse, we sometimes call it. It gets a momentum or a velocity and flies into the air. So that is how that particular spooky thing worked. Induction and the related phenomenon is called diamagnetism. We'll take questions at the end. Okay? It's called diamagnetism. And it's used in a lot of ways. It's really a very practical thing. So, you know, physics of Halloween is kind of fun, but also it's good to think about how these things really impact our life. And so induction is the basis of so many things that matter so much to the way we live life. One of them, this is a very similar device here, which, again, I can turn this on. You can hear it buzzing in the front? And that light tells me that it's on. And now the same thing's happening. There's a magnetic field that's changing. So this is going from North Pole to South Pole to North Pole to South Pole to North Pole to South Pole, one cycle, 60 times a second. And again, I have a ring with no visible connection to this, all right? But this is a ring of wire, not unlike this, this loop here, this ring of aluminum here. And as I bring it close, you can see what happens is that actually real energy is transferred. And that can be a tremendously useful thing. Huh? Can you think of a way to use it? All right, well, not surprisingly, it's used in many, many ways. For example, the electric grid, this picture was actually part of a PBS show that I found out about called America Revealed. It's really quite remarkable show, but this is sort of a visualization of how the electrical grid is connected in our country. If you zoom in on any one of those, what you'll see are these substations that are filled with transformers, big transmission wires, and one of the things that we can do with transformers, of course, is take very high voltages. In this particular substation, this is an OSHA picture, from 34 kilovolts in to 7 kilovolts out. It can be distributed into residential areas where it's transformed down into the household voltages that we use. In fact, nowadays, for a long time, almost all the voltages that we used in households were 120, and maybe for ovens and dryers, 240 volts, the RMS of the AC. But now we're using much smaller voltages quite a lot, right? Because most of what we're doing is charging cell phones and running LED light bulbs and things like that. And so we need to transform down even further. And one of the interesting applications of that are wireless chargers, which you see here. This is the Duracell power mat. That's just an ad. Induction cooking is kind of a neat thing, if anybody does that. That works in very much the same way. Instead of lighting light bulbs, one thing that can happen is, I'm going to ask, I need a volunteer again. And we just need volunteers with senses. Come here, young man. All right? Okay. What would you say the approximate temperature compared to the room is of that ring?
Probably 260.115 Kelvin.
Excellent. All right. It's not a plant. All right. Now, I'm going to just do this experiment without the kinetic energy. And, you know, the thing is, I did it a little too much. So I'm going to just ask you to touch that very briefly. Touch it with your fingers. Well, maybe a little less briefly. I can do it, okay? There you go. What do you think?
It's probably 500 Kelvin.
It's hot. All right. So maybe it's about 60 centigrade or something like that. But it's really hot. So I induction heated this ring just doing the same thing. This, I understand, you shouldn't try to do at home. Is cut a frying pan in half. Thanks. You did a great job. Cut a frying pan in half and shows that when you have the material that absorbs the heat, it melts butter. But when you have the material that doesn't absorb the heat, it doesn't really melt butter. Another application here is induction welding. I think this is a remarkable thing that I saw. So a huge pipeline, this is a huge iron pipe, and in order to put two sections of this together, they have to weld it. And the way they do that is by winding an electromagnetic coil around it, hooked up to a truck that provides a big alternating current, and that welds the pipe. Just a remarkable thing. Let's see, maglev trains. They are suspended and in some time cases driven by electric and magnetic forces. Electric guitars, I needed a picture for that. So this is the one I found. Ooh, there it is. We're still looking for Bonnie Raitt, but there are some guitar greats there, yeah. And then this thing, diamagnetism, the dia part of diamagnetism or dia, anything like diameter, means opposing. And the effects that we see, that this thing flies away from the strong magnetic field, is like opposing a change. And one of the ways in which this is used, this is the Millennium Force at Cedar Point. And many roller coasters use what's called eddy current braking, which is essentially taking advantage of this. And one of the things about eddy current braking is it's sort of very smooth, exponential decay until you see here at about 9 seconds that you put on a mechanical brake to bring it all the way to rest. So an exponential decay would actually never stop. But that's a friction brake that takes over. And finally, there's this thing called a rail gun, which we decided not to show today. But this is the textbook picture that we show students. Oftentimes, physics students don't believe that anything we show them exists, but it really does. Apparently, the Navy's bought these things. And if nothing else, you can tell that at the right end of this, there is an electromagnetic coil. Okay, now perfect diamagnetism is another phenomenon. So here's a question. All right, I explain this because there's currents flowing. You saw it light up light bulbs, etc. There's currents flowing. So my quick question to you is, if I want current to flow with no power loss, without eddy current heating that you could cook with or burn or very accurately determine the temperature of, what requirement would provide for no power loss at all? Okay? Absolute zero temperature is actually in some cases true, but not necessarily always true, but zero electrical resistance. And the reason is that the power lost, the power converted to heat, in terms of something that we call electrical resistance, R can be many things. In this case, it's electrical resistance, is the square of the current times R. Now, we want the current, because that does useful things. But we want to have zero R. And it turns out that there are materials that do this. So you got it right. And these are called superconductors. And I just happen to have some here. The thing is that the graph that I show you here is the resistance of a particular chunk of material. Sorry. Okay. The resistance is the vertical axis versus temperature in Kelvin, where absolute zero is on this graph. And room temperature is essentially at the far right end of this graph. And 80 degrees Kelvin is at that point where the electrical resistance goes to zero. I need to make 88 degrees Kelvin. How do I do that? Okay. Well, we can't resist. It's Halloween. So we do it with cool stuff. Which is, of course, this is actually very accessible in a lot of ways. Who does, you know? It used to be that this is such a novelty, and now everybody is just so jaded. They've seen quite a lot. We're really going to run out of time. You know? Really a lot of liquid nitrogen here. I have an idea for that, but I'll talk to you about it in a minute, Monica. At any rate, yeah. So I need cameras. You got that? Okay. Superconductor. One, two. Okay, there. Okay, so this material is actually the kind of material that I showed you the graph of. And it does, I'm just going to pull this out for a sec. As you cool it, which I'm going to do with liquid nitrogen, it turns into a superconductor, and when it turns into a superconductor, currents can flow anywhere through that material with no energy. It requires no power and no energy to do that. Now, cooling things is kind of interesting in its own right. The people who do this professionally are called, cryogenists? And the whole field is called cryogenics, you know, making cold. And for some reason, the real pioneers were from Finland. Now, I just put some water in here. I don't know if you can all see this thing. Or let me put it on the table so you can see it. Yeah. I always like to say that it's very safe. You guys are too. All right, at any rate, yeah. So let me just start by doing sort of a Halloween effect thing, right? And you probably can't do that at home, but you can get dry ice. When you try to cool things, the liquids are very, very effective for cooling things. And the reason is that it can take up a lot of heat, okay? And of course it's cold and it's fairly massive. The problem is that if you take a liquid and pour it on something hot, this is a liquid, this, material is hot. It's at room temperature, much, much hotter, a much higher temperature than this. And so as you do this, what unfortunately happens is, what happens when you pour a liquid on something hot, usually? Okay, it boils, right? And so instead of being a liquid, it's a gas. And the gas doesn't conduct heat very well. And so it's difficult to cool things. Sometimes it protects you. If you want to see if a pan is hot or an iron is hot, you sometimes lick your finger and touch it, and you get that little psst. It makes gas, and that is an insulating layer that protects your finger, at least momentarily, from that. So remember that that we have this diamagnetism, the property of nature opposing, making magnets, basically, electromagnets, currents flowing to oppose a change. This is a magnet, and I'm going to let this cool. It's still boiling. It's not cold enough. But when it stops boiling, it'll be cold enough. Oops. Meanwhile, I'm going to cool this thing. I'll tell you about it in a minute. Is that in the way? Oh, that's horrible. That was a bad idea. Okay, I'll do that later. All right. So it's getting there. This isn't why this is taking so long. Okay, so now I'm going to bring the magnet to the superconductor. As I bring it in, currents must be flowing because the magnetic field is changing. And at some point, it's going to be very, very cooperative eventually. Okay, it's floating and spinning. So that's called perfect diamagnetism. This is essentially how it works. That's a picture that doesn't look at all unlike what we've created here. So we can do it any day that we want. What I did was I brought the magnet down onto the superconductor. The change made currents flow, and remember that it makes it work in such a way that the poles oppose each other, and it can quickly and always adjust to any motion up to some point and just suspends the magnet like that. So that's how this perfect diamagnet works. I guess I'm not going to do the other one for the sake of time. All right, so I've got this liquid nitrogen out here. The whole phenomena that we're looking at are superconductors. They're used in a lot of things. Most applications of superconductors are not this kind that you can do at liquid nitrogen temperature. It's great for lecture demonstrations, Saturday morning physics and Halloween shows. But in real applications, things are actually cooled with liquid helium to below 10 degrees Kelvin, and they have applications in medicine with magnetic resonance imaging, in making big magnets for research, such as the magnets at the Large Hadron Collider. This is an MRI machine. And this is an interesting application, which are ways of measuring magnetic fields. Okay, not only do we see these magnetic repulsion or diamagnetic effects, but you can actually use them to measure magnetic fields. And this is called magnetocardiology, which, among other applications, can separate the mother's heartbeat from a child's heartbeat. And power transmission is sort of a research topic, but not yet practical. They asked me to try one other thing, given that it's Halloween. And so now the safety equipment is important. Let's see. Sorry. One thing I want to try is using an actually cooled ring. All right? And I'll just remind you that the amount of current that can flow depends, among other things, on the amount of energy lost on the resistance. And so the resistance of this, wow, it's bright up there. It's hard to see. But this has been cooled to liquid nitrogen temperature. And if you remember that graph of resistance, it turns out that the resistance gets smaller even for aluminum. It's not a superconductor, but it is a better conductor, so more current can flow. And it becomes, whoa, a better magnet and a cold one. So finally, you made me do it. Okay. I just want to assure everyone that that I did not do this as a teenager. But I've never done it before. It's never been done before. smashing a liquid nitrogen-cooled pumpkin. So I just want to see what happens. You guys game? Is it big enough? All right, here we go. Can you see it? It worked. Now we got to clean it up before it melts, right? All right, good. So look, time-wise. We have more physics of Halloween, but I think at some point we're going to stop filming, right? So we're going to do one more section and then break or whatever we do, normal break, but then we'll finish. So we're going to do this all for you today, but we're going to go a little faster, among other things. Okay? Watch out, there are little bits of pumpkin on the ground. Yep.
Okay, now, you know, some people think that ghosts and goblins are made out of plasma. But physicists know that plasma is just ionized atoms. You ionize an atom by ripping it apart with an electric field, and the atoms inside get excited, the electrons get excited, and they fall back down through the various energy levels and generate light, and it forms this plasma across the arc there, and it's buoyant because it has a lower density, so it rises up like so. And we have a bunch of different plasma generators here. By the way, plasma can be generated with electric arc, it can be generated by a flame as a plasma. You can heat something as a plasma. So I'm just going to turn these things on. Where is the switch in this thing? There we go. Where is that thing? How do you turn this on? Where's the on switch there? Could you just turn it? Yeah. So while those are going, I just want to note, by the way, can you turn this slide on? That, you know, I'm a capacitor. And so I can conduct through a capacitor. DC can't go through a capacitor. It's an open thing. But AC can. And so I... And using the well-known spherical ghost model, the capacitance of a sphere, and I'm going to assume I'm a sphere, is 100, in picofarads, is 100 times R, where R is my radius, let's say a half a meter or something. So I'm about a 50 picofarads. So this capacitance can pass the electrical current through my skin because it's AC, and I can guide the plasma discharge, which is kind of like that, except it's... See, like that? But flames are also a plasma. So I'm going to put some alcohol in here. Let's see if we can detect any ghosts. How would we detect a ghost? Well, the flame would form a certain pattern, I think, as the ghost moves around. Let's see what happens. Whoa! Think there's a ghost in there? Okay. So our ghost over here is going to use the capacitance of his two hands to play some spooky music on a theremin, using being able to change the capacitance by changing the distance from the... This one controls frequency and that controls amplitude. Here is the flame tube, and we're going to produce standing waves in this tube with this speaker. Okay, and I'm going to Oh, lights. See, there they got four. Now I have five standing waves in there. Six. Seven. Eight. Two, three, four, five, six, seven. I got nine. I think that's the best I can do. No, no, there's 10. Okay. You don't have to guess? Okay. That's plasma for you. Yeah, I'm good.
All right, great. All right, one last topic.
And maybe we'll start with the physics. I don't know.
Here, I'll take the silver one. Let's start here. All right. So, is that working?
Yeah.
Is that anywhere as cool as the plasma? I don't know. All right. I mean, the plasma really is physics. It looks like ghosts. But, yeah, so what? Who knows what I've got going on here? Anybody? Well, basically, I'm transmitting light from the cone here, which has different colored lights in it, into the
fibers.
Very good. Thank you. I needed the word. All right. So yeah, these are fibers, and these are actually just fibers of glass. Actually, just really drawn thin fibers of glass, and this is a tremendously, again, useful, I like to talk about the useful things, tremendously useful physical phenomenon, which I just have a little background on for you here, okay, so there's this thing, and basically this is, are these called light guides and fiber optics, and the way they work is that when you have light going from some material that we call optically denser, like glass, into air, whenever there's a boundary, rays of light, a little bit gets reflected and a little bit gets transmitted. And, or actually not a little bit, but some of it gets reflected and some of it gets transmitted is what I meant to say. And here you have one example of the transmitted light through this boundary. This happens all the time. If you're underwater, you can look up and you can tell it, it doesn't look very clear, but you can tell that there's things going on above the water, usually. But if it turns out that as the angle moves away from this perpendicular, which we call the normal, there is a special angle called the critical angle at which it's impossible for the light to be bent at the boundary, and therefore it must stay within this medium, this glass, and we call that total internal, inside the glass, reflection. And you can take advantage of that by making, if we just have these fibers of glass that we have here, it's a little bit of a primitive way to do that. And But a real fiber optic cable or a fiber optic transmission thing is made in this way, and the light just stays inside and bounces around. So you can guide light, and maybe by turning the light on and off, you can encode information in it, and it's used in a wide variety of things. So that's really all there is to it. Light is done does what's called refracting. It refracts in such a way that it stays inside the medium. It's internal to the medium. So again, there are quite a number of applications. There's telecom, at least over large distances, fairly lossless and wide bandwidth telecom applications. This is some kind of telecom fiber. It's also used in electrical isolation. When you don't want wires carrying the digital information, for example, in signals, you can actually carry it in pulses of light in these fibers. There's remote optical sensing of many sorts that are used. And I don't have a picture of the endoscopy application, if you don't mind. Okay, so, so really that's all there is to it. There's a few other demos that we have of, you know, the fiber optic things that kind of make it clear what's going on. But I thought the best thing to do, I turned on the wrong thing. All right, here. I thought the best thing, well, fine, that's kind of the rudiments of an endoscope. I thought the best thing to do was just to demonstrate this phenomenon in a way that was kind of unexpected, unusual, all right? So the technology that we talked about used glass. You can actually use combinations of glass to make it work better, and you can tune the index of refraction with the kind of glass and things like that. But any medium that is more optically dense than air, like water, works. Okay, that was an example that I gave. So let me take a laser beam here, and can you see I'm shining it through this this water? Okay. Okay. Well, we'll turn the lights down in just a sec. I'll turn that off. I can't turn that off. Okay. Good. All right. But what I'm going to do, actually, is start the stream of water flowing. This is another trick you can do. You can take a bottle, put a lid on a bottle, and put a hole in it, and the water doesn't come out because the pressure up here is lower than the pressure on the outside, and that supports this much head of water, as we say. But if I let the air in the top by loosening this, then I get a stream of water here. And the interesting, we should have the lights down, I think, to see that. You see, the interesting thing about this stream of water is that it's guiding the light into the bucket. Isn't that cool? So, you know, all you need is a laser pointer, and you can do that at home. Anyway, I think that's it. I can't see. Right. So that's the physics of Halloween. And are there any questions?